a woman, and that's Radio Clyde. You just can't lose, but all that music makes you feel so good inside.
I think every one of us is desperate to get some kind of affirmation that we exist and that we matter. And the most efficient way of getting that in the final analysis is by dealing decently with the people around us. And all of those people who are always grabbing for the short-range advantages and will often find in the long range they're losing.
All my life's a circle, sunrise and sundown.
On the evening of Thursday, 16th July, 1981, while driving to a gig in New York, Harry Chapin met his death when his car crashed into a truck.
Harry Chapin was born on December 7th, 1942, in Greenwich Village, New York. His father worked as a drummer in the big band era with bands like Tommy Dorsey and Woody Herman. This musical background led Chapin and his three brothers to taking music lessons.
Harry started off playing classical trumpet, and that was his only instrument till 1957, when at the age of 15 he took up the guitar. When he left school, he went on to the Air Force College and then to Cornell University, where he studied architecture and philosophy.
After this, he formed the Chapin Brothers Band, but just on the edge of success in 1965, the band had to split up since his two brothers, Tom and Steve, were caught up in the Vietnam draft situation. They had to make the choice of college or rice paddies, and they chose college.
With the group temporarily disbanded, Harry Chapin went into the documentary film business and was soon editing, writing, directing, and producing. In 1969, he received an Academy Award nomination for the Best Feature Documentary and won first prizes at the New York and Atlanta film festivals.
In 1970, Tom and Steve Chapin reformed their band, and Harry started writing much of the material, developing his style of story songs. At the end of that year, there was a major slump in the film industry, and Harry applied for a taxi driver's license to help support his wife and kids. He never did drive a taxi because three movie offers came in the day he was supposed to start.
After he was finished making the three movies in the summer of 1971, Harry decided to return to the music business as a performer. By the end of the year, he was signed up to Elektra Records, and the following year, Taxi, the single that broke the three-minute rule, went soaring up the charts.
That's just some of the early history of Harry Chapin. His first visit to this country was not until 1977. But since then, he's made several tours over here. On each occasion, he gave the impression of having boundless energy. He devoted his life not only to an immensely successful career, but also to exceptional work for organizations devoted to improving the lot of all the people on this planet.
And the cats in the cradle and the silver spoon. I don't know when, but we'll get together then. Dad, we're gonna have a good time there. The very day I purchased it, I christened my guitar as my monophonic symphony, six-string orchestra. In my room I'd practice late, they'd leave me alone. My mother said, you're nothing yet to make the folks ride home. I'd play it all the talent nights, I'd finish, they'd applaud. Some called it muffled laughter, I just figured they were odd. So I went up for an encore, but they screamed they'd had enough. Or maybe I just need a group to help me do my stuff. And so I dream a bass will join me and fill the bottom in. And maybe now some lead guitar so it would not sound so thin. I need some drums to set the beat and help me keep in time. And way back in the distance, some strings would sound so fine. And we'd all play together like fine musicians should. And it would sound like music, and the music would sound good. But in real life I'm stuck with that same old formula. Me and my monophonic
phonic symphony, six string orchestra. I write love songs for my favorite girl and sing them soft and slow. But before I get to finish, she says she has to go. She's nice and says, excuse me, I've got to find a bar. I think I need refreshment before I hear you play guitar. Oh, I sent a demo tape I made to the record companies. Two came back, address unknown, one came back COD. Of course I got form letters, all saying pleasant things, like suggesting I should find a trade where I would not have to sing. And so I dream a bass will join me and fill the bottom in, and maybe now some lead guitar so it would not sound so thin. I need some drums to set the beat and help me keep in time, and way back in the distance some strings would sound so fine. And we'd all play together like fine musicians should, and it would sound like music, and the music would sound good. But in real life I'm stuck with that same old formula, me and my monophonic symphony, six string orchestra. Do it, fingers. Eat your heart out, Eric Clapton. I've been taking guitar lessons, but my teacher just took leave. It was something about a breakdown or needing a reprieve. I know I've found my future, so I will persevere and hold on to my dream of making music to their ears. And so I'll dream a bass will join me and fill the bottom in, and maybe now some lead guitar so it would not sound so thin. I need some drums to set the beat and help me keep in time, and way back in the distance some strings would sound so fine. I need all the help I can get, and we'd all play together like fine musicians should, and it would sound like music, and the music would sound good. But in real life I'm stuck with that same old formula, me and my monophonic symphony, six string orchestra. Oh, someday I'm gonna be a star.
We recently just were out in Los Angeles in the U.S., and they have a water shortage there. And there's the giant billboards all over California. And there's a guy in the shower, you know, you see from the waist up, washing himself and with his mouth open, singing, you know, while he's taking a shower. And this three-word caption, it says, sing shorter songs, which means, you know, cut down on your water usage. But I just thought it's obviously an ironic statement in terms of my career, because the first single I ever had, which was giant in the United States, not so big here because the time problem again hit over here, but was Taxi, which was 7 minutes long. And from that moment on, I was sort of typecast, and of course I did very little to change that, because it just, my method of songwriting is a very uneconomical one, in the sense that to make these mini movies, these oral movies as I call them, you have to take the time to set the situation in the words and let the story unfold.
It was raining hard in Frisco. I needed one more fare to make my night. A lady up ahead waved to flag me down. She got in at the light. Oh, where you going to, my lady blue? It's a shame you ruined your gown in the rain. She just looked out the window. She said 16 Parks Side Lane. Something about her was familiar. I could swear I'd seen her face before. But she said, I'm sure you're mistaken. And she didn't say anything more. It took a while, but she looked in the mirror. Then she glanced at the license for my name. A smile seemed to come to her slowly. It was a sad smile, just the same. And she said, how are you, Harry? I said, how are you, Sue? Through the too many miles and the two little smiles, I still remember you. It was somewhere in a fairy tale. I used to take her home in my car. We learned about love in the back of a Dodge. The lesson hadn't come too far. You see, she was gonna be an actress, and I was gonna learn to fly. She took off to find the footlights. I took off to find the sky. Whoa, I've got something inside me to drive a princess blind. There's a wild man wizard, he's hiding in me. In my mind. Oh, I've got something inside me, not what my life's about, 'cause I've been letting my outside drive me over till my time runs out. Whatever we had once was gone. So I turned my cab into the driveway, past the gate and the fine trim lawns. And she said, we must get together, but I knew it'd never be arranged. Then she handed me $20 for a $2.50 fare. She said, Harry, keep the change. Well, another man might have been angry, and another man might have been hurt, but another man never would have let her go. I stashed the bill in my shirt. and she walked away in silence. It's strange how you never know, but we'd both gotten what we'd asked for such a long, long time ago. You see, she was gonna be an actress, and I was gonna learn to fly. She took off to find the footlights, I took off for the sky. And here she's acting happy inside her handsome home. And me, I'm flying in my taxi, taking tips and getting stoned. I go flying so high when I'm stoned.
Very, very long concerts. I, at one time, had gotten to the point in the States where I was doing about four and a half hours, and I've got started getting complaints from the promoters because they were having to pay so much overtime to the stagehands. So I've had to promise people that I only go 3 hours. But what there will be is a general, I mean, there'll be all the hits. I'm not one of those performers who feels that I'm going to thwart the audience. The reasons they came partially is because they wanted to hear Taxi or Circles or WORLD or Cats in the Cradle or Bananas. I will play all those. But I also will do some from each album, and this is the, I guess, the eighth album I put out. And I will also do a good portion of the new songs. And what I will say that, see, I believe very strongly in not writing programs before I go out. Because to me, I feel far more secure in front of an audience, ironically, than I do before a microphone in the studio. And the reason is because the communication process is, by definition, a two-way street. And
you can actually see beyond the spotlight there.
Well, what I do is I feel it more. I mean, you can see the first couple of rows, but just from reflected light. But if you've played as many concerts as I have, and it has been in many kind of communication situations, I was a filmmaker, I was done, you know, so many different things, you start getting a feeling of where the audience is. And there's been some nights where it really is a mellowed out audience, and I will, you know, leave the tonality there much more. You know, I won't tend to herky-jerky them up and down. Other audiences, where they're sort of restless, you got to go up and down and, you know, and have sort of a variety. Some audiences that are downright raucous, you try to, you know, there's all kinds of tricks you use. But see, the problem with recording, even though there's a kind of wonderful permanence to it and a tactility, you know, you finish an album and it exists, you put it up on the shelf and it's always there. But the communication process is weird because you're not there when the person is experiencing it, and you only get the response 3 months later with a sales report, which may be nice for your bank book, but it's not as, you know, satisfying in terms of, as I say, really feeling where the other half is.
After dark, when the truck started down the hill that leads into Scranton, Pennsylvania, carrying 30,000 pounds of bananas, carrying 30,000 pounds, hitting big jump of bananas. It was a young job, and he was carrying the next day's pasty fruits for everyone in that cold, scarred city, where children played without despair in backyard slag piles, and folks managed to eat each day about 30,000 pounds of bananas. Yes, just about 30,000 pounds. Dream it again, Jim.
Of bananas.
Passed a sign that he should have seen, saying, shift the low gear, a $50 fine, my friend. He was thinking
thinking perhaps about the warm breath woman who was waiting at the journey's end. He started down the 2 mile drop, the curving road that wound from the top of the hill. He was pushing on through the shortening miles that ran down to the depot, just a few more miles to go. Then he'd go home and have her ease his long cramped day away and the smell of 30,000 pounds
of banana.
Yes, the smell of 30,000 pounds of banana. He was picking up speed as the city spread its twinkling lights below him. But it paid no heed as the shivering thoughts of the night's delights went through him. His foot nursed the brakes to slow him down, but the pedal floored easy without a sound. He said, "Christ!" It was funny how he had named the only man who could save him now. He was trapped inside a dead-end hillside, riding on his fear, hunchback was everywhere. One of those yellow, green, I'm telling you, 30,000 pounds
of banana.
Yes, there were 30,000 pounds of banana. He barely made the sweeping curve that led into the steepest grade. And he missed the thankful passing bus at 90 miles an hour. Lost his head, not to mention an arm or two, before he stopped. And he smeared for 400 yards along the hill that leads into Scranton, Pennsylvania. All those 30,000 pounds
of banana.
You know, the man who told me about it on the bus says it went up the hill out of Scranton, Pennsylvania. He shrugged his shoulders, he shook his head, and he said, and this is exactly what he said, "Boy, it sure must have been something. Just imagine 30,000 pounds of banana. Yes, there were 30,000 pounds of mashed bananas. Of bananas. Of bananas. Just bananas. 30,000 pounds of bananas. Not no driver now, just banana."
It was never a hit for me, but it's become probably my most popular song in the States. It's one that I get more requests from people in the United States for bananas than virtually anything. It's gotten to be almost like a religious rite, and people are coming from some other planet would wonder what. Here's this guy up on stage with his whole bunch, backup band of musicians, and people are bringing all these fruits and laying them at his feet, or occasionally throwing them at me, I must admit. But Then the other part of the light is right is people yelling out, "Harry, it sucks." So anyway, it's a funny song. It's a true song, but actually there's a tragic side to it because Scranton, Pennsylvania, where the song is, it's about this truck careening down the mountainside, 2 miles long, a 2 mile hill, and crashing at the bottom with 30,000 pounds of bananas. The driver was killed in real life, and his sister called me up about 2.5 years ago and asked me to stop singing the song, at least when I came to Scranton, because the only two times she said she'd seen her parents cry were when they heard about their son being killed, and when the two kids of the man who was killed came home from school crying because the people at school were singing bananas, you know, 30,000 pounds. So there's always a double-edged sword to every funny story, I guess.
A child arrived just the other day. He came to the world in the usual way, but there were planes to catch and bills to pay. He learned to walk while I was away, and he was talking for I knew it, and as he grew, he'd say, "I'm gonna be like you, Dad, you know I'm gonna be like you." And the cat's in the cradle and the silver spoon, little boy blue and the man on the moon. When you're coming home, Dad, I don't know when, but we'll get together then, you know we'll have a good time then. My son turned 10 just the other day. He said, "Thanks for the ball, Dad, come on, let's play. Can you teach me to throw?" I said, "Not today, I got a lot to do." He said, "That's okay," and he walked away, but his smile never dimmed and said, "I'm gonna be like him, yeah, you know I'm gonna be like him." And the cat's in the cradle and the silver spoon, the little boy blue and the man on the moon. When you're coming home, Dad, I don't know when, but we'll get together then, you know we'll have a good time then. Well, he came from college just the other day, so much like a man, I just had to say, "Son, I'm proud of you. Can you sit for a while?" He shook his head and he said with a smile, "What I'd really like, Dad, is to borrow the car keys. See you later, can I have them, please?" And the cat's in the cradle and the silver spoon, little boy blue and the man on the moon. When you're coming home, son, I don't know when, but we'll get together then, Dad, you know we'll have a good time then. I've long since retired, my son's moved away. I called him up just the other day. I said, "I'd like to see you if you don't mind." He said, "I'd love to, Dad, if I can find the time. You see, my new job's a hassle and the kids are the flu, but it's sure nice talking to you, Dad. It's been sure nice talking to you." And as I hung up the phone, it occurred to me, he'd grown up just like me. My boy was just like me. And the cat's in the cradle and the silver spoon, little boy blue and the man on the moon. When you're coming home, son, I don't know when, but we'll get together then, Dad. We're gonna have a good time then.
In the final analysis, that it's the second most basic form of music. I mean, these attitudinal songs are fairly new that other people do. The most basic kind of music, obviously, were chants and dances done in religious forms around campfires all the way back to the caveman days.
The second most basic was stories, because the legends of people, the traditions of people, the great stories of people were carried through poetry and music. And evidently Homer used to sit there blind as a bat with a three-string harp and do his long story songs, the Iliad and the Odyssey. And then people would hire him, and it'd take him 3 days sometimes, you know, whatever. Or Beowulf, you know, great epic, the British Isles, was done as in a sing-song way. The same thing with El Cid, the Spanish epic. So what happened is most of these, and indeed a lot of the news and stories in the Middle Ages was carried by troubadours who'd go and put it into music. This sort became when the printed word came in, and then when all the media of its, you know, radio, television, all the various aspects, newspapers came in, the need for this form of music diminished. And indeed, those media took over that whole aspect of storytelling. At the same time, I think we've come so far around the sophistication route that, in a sense, we've got such a surfeit of media right now that, in a funny kind of way, we've come back, I think, to the need to have apocryphal stories that sort of zero in on the kinds of decisions. And I was talking before about the political decision of having children. I mean, most of us don't realize the kinds of, and I sure don't, and it took my wife writing a poem, Zinging Me, for example, in Cats in the Cradle, to make me realize the kind of inherent decisions you make, political decisions even, and when you have children and the way you treat them.
All my life, sir. All my life's a circle, but I can't tell you why. The season's spinning round again, the years keep rolling by. It seems like I've been here before, I can't remember when, but I got this funny feeling that I'll be back once again. There's no straight lines make up my life, and all my roads have bends. There's no clear-cut beginnings, and so far no dead ends. I've found you a thousand times, I guess you've done the same. But then we lose each other, it's just like a children's game. But as I see you here again, the thought runs through my mind. Our love is like a circle, let's go round one more time. All my life's a circle, sunrise and sundown. The moon rolls through the nighttime till the daybreak comes around. All my life's a circle, but I can't tell you why. The season's spinning round again, the years keep rolling by. All my life's a circle, sunrise and sundown. The moon goes through the night time till the daybreak comes around. All my life's a circle, but I can't tell you why. The season's spinning round again, the years keep rolling by.
Well, the first long story song I really heard was by my father. It was about Stonewall Jackson, the Civil War general, and it was 11 minutes long, and it gave me courage to try it out. The other I was very attracted to Wallace Stevens as a poet. I didn't get into the narrative poets like Edward Ellington Robinson and some of the, you know, or Tennyson and some of the great English narrative poets. The most direct thrust, I would say, came from a poet named James Dickey, who wrote Deliverance, the film, and the book before that, and then has won book awards. And one of his poems, a thing called The Sheep Child, which is probably one of the weirdest poems ever written, but it suddenly freed me in the sense of realizing you can write almost about anything in the narrative form. And it's from the point of view of an offspring of a farm boy and a ewe speaking from a bottle of formaldehyde in the back of the Smithsonian Institute. Now, I mean, if that's got to be one of the weirdest premises from a poem, for a poem ever. And I suddenly, I mean, and it allowed me to, for example, on the first album, to write Dogtown, which was the first story song that I've ever written, which is implies bestiality. On that same album was Taxi, Greyhound, and the thing that immediately differentiated me from other singer-songwriters, and the reason that I got a fair amount of excitement created when I first got back into music in 1971, was that narrative impact that what you talk about. As a matter of fact, Billboard magazine, which is sort of the industry bible, that first year gave me its Trendsetter Award, and they called it for originating a narrative style of unique impact. Well, as we just talked about, obviously I didn't originate it. What I did was almost, in a sense, harken back to some very basic traditions.
Right. Did you suffer because of Dogtown? Were you criticized for that?
Well, I've been criticized very radically. I mean, you will very seldom read a Harry Chapin review that is either anything but a rave or a bomb. I have gotten some of the most incredibly negative reviews in the history of the music business. I mean, even witness Rolling Stone, which in terms of my political involvement has just wrote a major four-page article on, you know, involvement in the commission, and, you know, giving me tremendous credit, which I was grateful for. But last year, when they're talking about the Single of the Year Award, the worst Single of the Year Award, they called it the Honorable Harry Chapin Award. And they find that my music goes to mawkish, to sentimental, to, you know, I mean, they have a whole bunch of terminology. At the same time, I have other people like the London Times called the Dance Band Album the Album of the Year for 77. I've had, you know, many, many serious commentators say I'm, probably one of the best lyricists in the modern music scene, and truly one of the most unique ones in the sense of the narrative form. But I like that fact that I'm controversial. I'd much rather have those kinds of strong reactions than, oh, ho-hum, here we go again type of kind of thing. And I think especially in the modern music scene was the extraordinary amount of proficiency around, but there's very little differentiation in terms of something really, you know, unique and different. I think that the fact that I'm developing a body of work over this last 7 years that has a kind of shape that I think will hold up very well 20, 30, 40 years from now.
Up in Massachusetts, there's a little spit of land. The men who make the maps, yes, they call the place Cape Ann. The men who do the fishing call it Gloucester Harbor Sound. But the women left behind, they call the place Dogtown. The men go out for whaling past the breakers and the fogs. The women stay home waiting, they're protected by the dogs. A tough old whaler woman who had seen three husbands drown hold the population, and she named the place Dogtown. There's all these gray-faced women in their black widow's gowns living in this graveyard granite town. Yeah, you soon learn there's many more than one way to drown. That's while going to the dogs here in Dogtown.
town. And she speaks. My father was a merchant all in the Boston Fife. When my husband came and asked him for my hand, but little did I know then that a Gloucester whaler's wife marries but the sea salt and the sand. It took me up to Dogtown the day I was a bride. We had 10 days together before he left my side. He's the first mate of a whaling ship, the keeper of the log. He said, farewell, my darling, I'm going to leave you with my dog. And I have seen the splinter timbers of a 100 shattered hulls, all the silence of the granite and the screeching of the gulls. I've heard that crazy widow Cather walk the harbor as she raves at the endless rolling whisper of the waves. Sitting by the fireside, the embers slowly die. Is it a sign of weakness when a woman wants to cry? The dog is closely watching, the fire glints in his eye. No use to go to sleep this early, no use to even try. My blood beats like a woman's. I've got a woman's breasts and thighs. But where am I to offer them to the earth?
This talk is cheap.
I give up. It can't be Debbie Harry.
It's Pat Benatar's new album, Precious Time.
I'd have sworn it was a girl.
Pat Benatar is a girl, you wally. She's flavour of the month in the States, sold over 4 million albums.
Let's hear another track. Pat Benatar, eh? It's a funny name for a girl.
I'm crafty like a fox, I think, because in the short run, obviously writing Oobie Doobie Doo, I Love You, and putting it in a context of today's whatever the new hot sound is, be it punk rock or, you know, disco or whatever, would sell more records. But I don't think so in the long run. I think, you know, most of the bands that go that route alone almost self-destruct in the sense that they may have 1 or 2 years of heyday, but they don't have that long-lasting thing. The thing that's marked my career over the 6 years and plus in the States, and even what's happening here in England, is that the consistent build. Every year I come back to places and they're, you know, 50% more of an audience. And I've got the kind of career, I think, building that will mean that I'll be here doing it 20 years from now if I choose to. And I'll be playing to 4 times as many people as I'm playing to now. And it means that, to me, in a sense, I think quality in the long range sells and has more longevity than quantity. The ultimate example of that is when Taxi was out, which was my first hit. It sold about 500,000 copies. It didn't sell more because it didn't appeal to teeny boppers that much. It appealed to, you know, people from like 18 up. But at the same time it was selling 500,000 copies, there was another song called The Lion Sleeps Tonight, sung by a guy named Robert John, and it was the third number one version of that song. The first one was by the Weavers in 1952, had it sold over 1,000,000 copies. Second version was by the Tokens in 1962, sold over 1,000,000 copies, and Robert John's version sold 2.5 million copies worldwide. The irony is, of course, the week after we played together at a benefit for WFIL, which is a radio station down in Philadelphia in the United States, I was making $2,500 a night doing concerts, and he was making $1,000 a week playing roadhouses. Now, his record sold 5 times as much as mine did, and yet in the final analysis, I think the qualitative aspects of having a song like Taxi, which was unprecedented in American radio, even though it didn't sell as much, had far greater impact in the long run. And obviously, I mean, even in, finally in a dollars and cents sense, even overtook, in terms of what it's meant to my career, what it had, you know. And 6 months later, people said, whatever happened to that guy who sang that song? And it's, well, I don't know what's happened to him, but I'm just saying that I think in the long run, it's not just nobility or some, I think the fact is, in this life, if one works to do the best one can, in the long run, that is the most sensible decision as well as, you know, the right decision. I mean, it works both ways. It's a wonderful system.
Hello, honey, it's me. What did you think when you heard me back on the radio? What did the kids say when they knew it was their long-lost daddy-o? Remember how we listened to the radio and I said, that's the place to be. And how I got the job as an FM jock the day you married me. It was 2 kids and I was into AM rock, but I just had to run around. It's been 8 years since I left you, babe. Let me tell you about what's gone down. I am the morning DJ at WOLDD. Playing all the hits for you, wherever you may be. The bright good morning voice, who's heard but never seen. Feeling all the 45, going on 15. The drinking I did on my last big gig, it made my voice go low. They said that they liked the young sound when they let me go. So I drifted on down to Tulsa, Oklahoma, to do me a late night talk show. Now I've worked my way down home again here to Boise, Idaho. That's how this business goes. I am the morning DJ at WOLDD. Playing all the hits for you, wherever you may be. The bright good morning voice, who's heard but never seen. Feeling all the 45, going on 15. The money doing high school sock hops. I'm a big time guest MC. You should hear me talking to the little children and listen what they say to me. I got a spot on the top of my head, just begging for a new toupee. There's a tire around my gut from sitting on it, but it's never gonna go. Sometimes I get this crazy dream that I just take off in my car. But you can travel on 10,000 miles and still stay where you are. Thinking that I should stop this jockeying and start that record store. Maybe I could settle down if you take me back once more. Okay, honey, I see. I guess he's better than me. Sure, old girl, I understand. You don't have to worry, I'm such a happy man. I am the morning DJ at WOLDDDD, playing all the hits for you, wherever you may be. The great good morning voice, who's heard but never seen. Feeling all of 45, going on 15. I am the morning DJ at WOLDDDD.
I had a big mouth during the 60s. I used to say, why don't more successful people do more for the society? Or more, you know, all the standard stuff. And the worst thing that can happen is I have to come face to face with your own bull. And in 1972, I had a first hit. It was Taxi. And that fall, a song of mine was sung by the New Seekers. It was a big hit here in England and all around the world, Circle. And all of a sudden, I was successful. So I had a choice of calling my bluff or eating my words. And I decided I would try to do the former. And so I have been, as much as I can be, and probably I do more benefits than anybody else in the music business, and I try not to just do benefits, but also be involved in the subject matter. Indeed, over the last year since I was here, last I've been lobbying through Congress a resolution calling for a presidential commission on hunger, and indeed successfully persuaded the president last February 3rd when I went to see him with seven senators and eight congressmen to call such a commission. And it looks like they told me last week I was in Washington, they told me I will be on the commission. They'll be officially appointed in the middle of June. But this should not be unusual in our participatory democracies, because, I mean, whether you're a singer-songwriter, a reporter, a radio personality, a student, a housewife, a teacher, a businessman, whatever you are, the founding fathers of American democracy and the founding fathers of the whole English heritage, Scottish heritage, is all, I mean, the whole concept of participatory democracy means, very simply, I think it was Lord Acton who said, power corrupts, absolute power corrupts absolutely. And the whole idea is that all of us are not supposed to vote every time an election comes up, but also be actively involved as public citizens and be armchair experts on virtually everything from education to defense, welfare, ecology, economics, politics, hunger, and be sophisticated enough to ask the second, the third, the fourth, and the fifth question about any of these subject matters rather than just the first one. And to the extent that, I guess, all of the philosophy based on our systems of government, both America's and Britain's, is the fact that if you leave the business of government up to leaders alone, they're always going to mess it up. And so I think there's been very clear examples in the last two decades, both here and in America, of far too many of us leaving the business of government up to our leaders, and we've seen very clearly to the degree that messed it up. Yes, there are a lot of compromises involved in a participatory democracy where we all argue, stew in our homes, churches, taverns, street corners about all these issues. But at the same time, those compromises are usually more effective than when you put three leaders in a room and have them tell us what to do. So I think it's very clear, if we aren't happy with what's happening in our respective societies, the responsibility, in a sense, comes back to us. And I would like to think that, you know, I mean, the whole fact that I'm involved socially to the degree that I am is not an unusual thing. It is unusual in the music business, and I've been sort of taking the music business to task. Over the last album was called Dance Band on the Titanic, because right. felt that whole process of us creating diversions in the ballroom rather than worrying about the icebergs outside.
So that is socially significant. I mean, that is a representative symbolic album, if you like, saying, look at what's happening to our world in 1978.
Yeah, well, that album was like two bookends around 12 stories. There were 14 songs. The first song on the album was Dance Band on the Titanic, which was an ironic look at the kind of ego that the builders of the Titanic, you know, like even God couldn't sink this ship. Well, obviously, it was on its maiden voyage, the unsinkable vessel sank. And the last song on the album is a 14-minute compendium of my thoughts of how the interrelationship between young singer-songwriters and the world and myself, the America's 200th anniversary, you know, the bicentennial, and the way music should interact with politics. In between were 12 individual stories like they were taking place in different cabins, as it were, on the Titanic, ranging from the steerage third class all the way to first class sumptuous salons. And I think my music, in one sense, could fit in that whole thing. In other words, what I do is occasionally make a social comment, but in general, it's like it's like pointillism. They're individual stories that all taken together give a fabric of the society.
Dance band on the Titanic, sing here my cup to thee. The iceberg's on the starboard bow, won't you dance with me?
Mama stood crying at the dockside, saying, please, son, don't take this trip. I said, Mama, sweet mama, don't you worry none. Even God couldn't sink this ship. Well, the whistle blew, and they turned the screws. It turned the water into foam. Destination, sweet salvation. Goodbye, home, sweet home. I'm in the dance band on the Titanic, sing near my God to thee. The iceberg's on the starboard bow, won't you dance with me? There was a trombone and a saxophone. The bass and drums were cooking on a bandstand, and I was strumming in the middle with his dude on a fiddle. And we were 3 days out from land. Now the foghorn's jammed and moaning, hear it groaning through the misty night. I heard the lookout shout down, there's icebergs around, but still everything's alright. Oh, the dance band on the Titanic, sing near my God to thee. The iceberg's on the starboard bow, won't you dance with me? They were burning all the flares for candles in the banquet. They were throwing in first class, and we were blowing waltzes in the ballroom when the universe went crash. Chaplain say, women and children and chaplains first. Well, they soon used up all of the lifeboats, but there were a lot of us left on board. I heard the drummer saying, boys, just keep playing, now we're doing this dance.